Spiral model is the central model for spiral dynamics, and it includes 8 levels of development. And each level of development relates to a cultural level, a cultural reality, a psychological reality, and a cognitive reality for human beings, a whole worldview. And in the first tier of the spiral, there are 6 levels, and that basically takes us from 100,000 years ago to the present time. There are 2 new levels on the horizon. We're beginning to see evidence of those 2 new levels, and they're what spiral dynamics calls second tier. So this constitutes a new leap forward. And in the view of Dr. Don Beck and the view of spiral dynamics, this next leap is what's going to be required for us to actually respond to the kinds of crises that we're faced with as a human species at this point in time. So we've gone through, really, in a certain sense, the first chapter, grand chapter of human history from 100,000 years ago to the present. And now we're at this point where, you know, the world is fraught with unprecedented complexity and conflict, and where we're going to literally have to leap to a new order of being.
So my job is to lay down a map that's the result of years of very careful scientific academic research and years of field testing. My name is Don, if you wish to call me that. I will simply walk through these systems with you. We use music to illustrate them because they are bio, psycho, social, spiritual systems. They're ways of thinking. They're value systems. It's not about IQ or intelligence of that nature. It's not about EQ or the new emotional intelligence. It's about a different kind of human intelligence. It's one that arises in response to life conditions. And so it's an adaptive intelligence, one that is contextual, one that emerges in people and societies in response to the challenges of life conditions that in turn are the product of our successes. What is that quest within us as humans? To solve one set of problems and create a new set in their place. That's the topic for today.
So in the first tier of the spiral, there are 6 levels of development, beginning with beige, which is what occurred beginning 100,000 years ago. And this is the most survival-oriented paradigm, worldview. These are people who were living pretty much hand-to-mouth, you know, in various parts of the world, not particularly organized into well-developed groups, you know, but are literally in a subsistence mode.
So express self automatically so as to meet the basic physiological needs, food, warmth, reproduction. Now we are a long way from this system in our priority state. But you can imagine places like Ethiopia or Rwanda where there's starvation, or even the father eats first. Because if the father dies, the family dies. Or like in the Northwest Arctic, when I was there with Inuits and Yellowknife, Northwest Canada, who speak a Nootutut, told stories of grandma and granddad who get an ice floe and just disappear. Because they calculated how much food there is for the babies and saw it not enough for them. And in that beige clan system, that was logical, rational behavior. Then came the royal mounted police and accused that family of murder. Can you see the meme clash between them? That in that basic survival band, grandma and granddad disappeared willingly, gladly.
In the purple meme, which is the second level of the spiral, those groups become organized into more well-constituted clans or family groupings. And so there's the beginning of a kind of cultural development there where people are also beginning to make kinds of connections, which we could at this point in time call superstitious, but in fact they were beginning to make connections in their own minds between events. So they were seeing, okay, there's actually cause and effect. And this is a huge kind of, you know, you might say biopsychosocial development in human consciousness and in human culture. So that they're saying, if I do this, then this will happen, you know. If there's a full moon, then this will happen, you know. And some of these things ring true today and some of them don't. But in fact, this was an enormous leap forward, really, for human beings.
So now, a magical place, alive with spirit beings and mystical science.
When you wish upon a star, make no difference who you are, anything your heart desires.
I wish you could be up here and look at the smiling faces right now. So in purple then, sacrifice to the wishes of the elder spirits and ancestors to gain safety and security for the tribe-like group in a frightening world. So many who have a good purple system in them are able to tune into frequencies because their brain has, like a radio transmitter, has crystals that send out frequencies, send and receive on different. So when you tune your radio or your TV channel, you in a sense are tuning to a frequency. Each of these meme codes has its own frequencies. That's why some people can resonate purple, other people can't hear it. It's not in their brain to have the antennas to pick up on purple. So ideally we create communities, fellowships, companies, communities of all kinds, worlds, where there are multiple frequencies, and the extent to which we do that, to that extent we are healthier humans.
There was the beginning of rites and rites of passage and so on that you know people felt were very important, and some of these had to do with sacrifice and with rites of passage for young people that were often, you know, very painful, and human sacrifice. You know, these were some of the things which were found, began to be initiated at that time. Now, the kind of pressure that put on individuals wasn't always positive, and it precipitated ultimately a breakthrough into the red level, which was a very individualistic level. It's where people said, look, I want to be my own person. I don't necessarily want to be, I don't want to be necessarily part of these kinds of rites. You know, I don't want to be forced to be a part of the clannish context in a way where, you know, there was a sort of stifling, claustrophobic sense to it. Mm-hmm. So you get this very strong red individualistic, you know, every man for himself, you know, kind of impulse.
A jungle where the strongest and most cunning survive. So it's tough, assertive, bold, unconstrained by consequences of guilt. It's the unconstrained, raw sense of freedom that has no boundaries. But in a heavy red environment, shame is there, loss of face, don't disrespect me. And red is quick to see insults. Red is certain that they're out to get him. Because red needs dragons to slay. If there aren't any real dragons, we'll find one. Because this heroic sense of I must slay a dragon, you see, is simply one of the manifestations of this deeper red code. And if you watch little kids, you can begin to see that challenging authority, challenging boundaries. I'm doing it on my own. Don't need help from you. Take my sack and my lunch and my blanket. I want to run away from home. See there. Dependence, how that can crystallize into this kind of rebellious system later on, because it wasn't facilitated as a healthy meme excursion. In fact, it could have been reinforced. frequency. So we breed children who have a heavy red system that's activated, of course, by cocaine and crack, and give that instant rush, and wonder why our prisons are full of kids that have no business being there. Because the entire societal habitat and milieu has unhappily not dealt with that emerging sense of raw self. And we pay a heavy price because of it. Unresolved subsystem red problems that often we bring with us even to our grave.
So in the case of this third system, or meme, which is designated by the color red, you got to the point where, you know, there was a kind of chaotic situation where every man for himself, these feudal empires, you know, were really destructive enough that people said, no, we have to create a larger order. You know, we have to go back to, or higher to an order that will bring people into a constructive kind of social contract. So this is also the beginning of the fourth system, which is designated blue, and which corresponds to the beginning of organized religion. So that people were then answering to a god, which they collectively recognized. You have the beginning of Christianity, of Judaism during this period of time, and people were encouraged to sacrifice for that, so that there was then the sense of a kind of internal order, you know, that structured society and created an antidote, you know, to this mayhem, you know, that arose out of the previous system, which was red.
An ordered existence under the control of the ultimate truth. The fire within us, the passion for. That's the original impulse around the blue mean. A reason for existence that transcends self. A purpose for living that subdues the raw, burning desire of red. For a person to sacrifice to something greater, nobler, that has meaning. That's the essence, you see, of the beginning of the blue mimetic. That's why it forms the great living world religions. That's why it inserts a sense of purpose. That's why men and women have been able to die for an abstraction to make the world safe for democracy, or whatever that happens to be. So in this transformation out of red into blue, it's a very dangerous trip because of the extremes in both of them. And today we see millions of people trying to navigate from red to blue. So around this blue meme is rich meaning, and it is a subsystem that contributes to our ability in the more complex, what we call second tier zones, to reignite the idea of purpose and commune for something larger than self, not an ism, not a religion, not a patriotic fervor with only the privileged group of people. But if we are going to be responsible as humans and understand how and why we go through these major conflicts and transformations, if that is going to be what we want to commit ourselves to, then it's going to require this subsystem that enables us to bond not to a tribe, not to a small group of people, but to a transcendent purpose for which we're willing to sacrifice self. And that's what I'm sensing many people are searching for just now.
The blue system is the fourth system, and at a certain point of in time, particularly I think because of the plagues, because the organized religion basically got to a point where it was stifling, again, human independence in a certain way, the independence of the individual, you know, that people began to feel also that it was not answering the life conditions of the time. So when the plagues went through Europe at that point and basically wiped out, you know, millions and millions of people, there was a tremendous crisis of faith. And so people were saying, look, we don't feel actually that the priests and the churches are protecting us, you know, and this isn't functioning. And that gave rise to the Enlightenment period, which is the orange fifth system. And that's a system, a worldview that's characterized by the scientific method, by saying, look, we can create heaven on earth. We have that kind of power. And it was the development of those kinds of cognitive abilities and the entire way in which modern science gave rise to, observation and experimentation and creating the material grounds for a whole new society.
So what is the world? In the orange mimetic, a marketplace full of possibilities and opportunities.
Just what makes that little old ant think he'll move that rubber tree plant? Anyone knows an ant can't move a rubber tree plant, but he's got high hopes. He's got high hopes. He's got high apple.
It's enterprising. Self. It's not the materialistic self. It's the enterprising. It's the innovative. It's the scientific. It's the exploration. It's the venture out. It's the wanderlust. That's what this self really is. So we're talking here about the core of the meme intelligence that has first this optimism, high hopes, but it's not naive. It calculates, it reads, it maneuvers. If you learn to play the cards right, you can make your pile, says Orange. Translated, you can cause change to happen. Just like the cutting edge of blue is transcendent purpose, fire in our hearts. The cutting edge of orange is a belief in changeability. Further, humans can impact the change. Further, I can impact the change. So you see how the orange code has the assumption of changeability. Because after all, Charles Darwin showed us species can change. We have enough evidence today about changing people and changing. So change rather than fatalistic determinism is the order of things. Oh, so there is an invisible hand after all. If there is, why don't we learn the game? Why don't we play the game better than anybody else? Now, we can play the game for our own self-advancement, to build barns and bigger barns. Or we can play the game for an essential cause that is critical for the species history.
The effects of the orange system then, which began with the Enlightenment period, gave rise to industrialization. So people were populating the world in a very different way with incredible means to, exploit natural resources and exploit other people. So while there was a tremendous material benefit to that, ultimately people began to see, well, this is detrimental to the human person, because the human being is being seen as, as a cog in the wheel. And there's a lack of a kind of humanistic dimension to this that really needs to be there. So the orange system in its excesses, gave rise to the green system, which is the postmodern system, which emphasizes human rights, and it emphasizes a much more humanistic approach, a much more communal approach to human life, to try and address some of those problems, to see, actually each human being counts.
From a marketplace full of possibilities and opportunities to a human habitat now, in which we share is a big word. I want to share life's experiences and thus value communities. All together now and do what? Plan the next time to be all together.
All together now.
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 Now, the idea of all together now, black, white, brown, it's a wonderful message, isn't it? Because it's one of the early ways to address discrimination, categories for people, rank order system, that some people are more privileged than others. And so we have been in our society through a wonderful cleansing experience. And the upside of this has been that we've crashed in walls that divided us. And for that reason, we have a lot to be grateful. As Ken Wilber says, the many gifts of green have been this, have been to address these issues of the left behind in a way that no one should be. And so in terms of legislation, in terms of civil rights passage and human rights emphasis, and some of the deconstruction attempts to say that the white Eurocentric European male experience is not the only experience on the planet, after all. So sacrifice now to obtain when? Now. Not future, now. Not lay by in store for the rainy day, now. Consume what we have been given and add nothing to it. Because we found the ultimate truth about things, and therefore it's our job to redistribute what we already have. Don't build any more, because that's bad. So the theme is redistribution of resources, not the creation of new ones. And certainly new ideas not to be allowed, because they come from elites. And we know in Australia about tall poppies. And so we have education systems at high school level that have banned honor societies, because it separates students into levels. Red is beautiful, white is beautiful, black is beautiful, yellow is beautiful, people is beautiful. But each of the meme codes, when it designs its own, tends to see it as a final state. Green without a good orange subsystem dies on the vine, as it is, because it promises more than it can deliver. It's a characteristic each of the meme codes can see the world and its problems, but it cannot solve them. It takes the next one to solve them. Isn't that Einstein's quotation once again?
But at this point in time, what so many of us benefit from, you know, which are the freedoms of postmodernism, the freedoms of the green meme and the communal and egalitarian worldview, you know, that has seems to have given rise also to a kind of self-satisfaction. Here we are, very comfortable, we live very comfortably, we have, you know, for most of us, you know, we have everything that we could need, we have the higher standard of living in the world. And that self-satisfaction is itself the problem, because of where we're at, because of actually the real crisis that the world is in. So you could also see that self-satisfaction as, not, you know, as narcissism, that it, you know, the green meme, which has given every human being their place in the sun, you know, has also led to a kind of affirmation of the human being. And we can't stop with the kind of narcissism that has basically led to. So that's the downside of that individualism, you know, is the narcissism. So where we're at now, you know, as a global culture now, I mean, basically we're all interconnected, and we can see that, you know, the complexity and the tremendous, you know, conflict and environmental degradation. I mean, there's so many problems that the human race is confronted with that it's clear that we need, you know, a next order, a higher order of thinking and understanding, and you know, Spiral Dynamics proposes that it's the theory itself which can be a very helpful tool in actually creating, you know, the next move, the next leap, as they say, you know, to a higher level of thinking and perceiving.
And now the great leap into second tier. I'm convinced, after being where I've been over the last few years, I'm convinced it's now possible, it's seriously now possible, to provide the kinds of answers so many people are now searching for, and do so in a practical, caring, reality-based, on-the-ground manner. For that to occur, then, we have to combine the thinking modalities in these two memes. What occurs in the first six systems are steady states. What occurs in the second tier systems in yellow is flow. Flow meaning one is not taught one single spiritual message and outcome. One is taught transformational spirituality, realizing that each plateau is reached is a prelude to the next and to the next in this never-ending quest of ours. So yellow integrates and flows. Express self, it's a warm color system, but never at the expense of others or the earth, so that all life, not just my life, may continue in the most natural, fitting ways. Now one expresses self in this area, not like red expression of self, not like orange expression of self, but a different in yellow expression of individuality. So now the holistic mesh, the eighth code, second tier. Sacrifice interests of self, see that in turquoise? And others as necessary. Why? So as to reach balance and harmony among humans, the planet, and generations to come. Why? For the survival of life itself. Not for a cause, not for an ism, not for a belief, but for life itself. So we have in yellow life flow, and we have in turquoise life preservation. And the two fit together. And the key in second tier is the meshwork of the individual and the collective, where ends the war between them, because it facilitates the movement between them on the part of individual and groupings. So rather than a static model of who influences whom to do what, this kind of yellow turquoise entity is able to form task force teams where people quickly join in to assume roles necessary, and then when the task is over, they disband. So you become part not of a single community with assigned roles, but part of a flexible flow based upon tasks to be performed. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? So I wish for you an integral commons and a holistic meshworks. You say, fine. Give us the rule book and the guidebook for these kind of communities. I say, go write it yourself.